October 30, 1961, Novaya Zemlya Archipelago, Northern Russia. October 30, 1961 could have been just another regular day. In a perfect world, this video wouldn't even exist. But at 10,500 meters up, a Tupolev Tu-95 was about to make October 30, 1961, a date for the history books. And that day would forever be known as the day we created the second sun on Earth. The story of the hydrogen bomb is unique, and it goes hand in hand with a time in history when advancements were made in creating weapons of mass destruction. Even though the first design for a nuclear bomb was the nuclear fission kind, which came out of the Manhattan Project during World War II, the idea of using fusion to unleash unheard-of amounts of energy popped up around the same time. To the best of our knowledge at present, it was the physicists Enrico Fermi and Edward Teller who initially proposed that a nuclear fusion bomb could be formed by detonating a nuclear fission bomb. This is still in 1941, 4 years remained before the first nuclear explosion in history. As World War II worsened, countries poured resources into their own nuclear weapons research projects in response to the deteriorating situation. The Manhattan Project in the US was highly successful, but to get why the hydrogen bomb came about so quickly after the first nukes, we gotta grasp the scene the world was in at the time. Physicist Edward Teller dedicated his time to the Manhattan Project, focusing efforts on a nuclear fusion bomb concept. But the main problem he was dealing with at that time was the struggle to make theoretical predictions and do the necessary math to figure out how fusion behaved. On the flip side, fission bombs, like the ones dropped on Hiroshima, were way more testable, especially since nuclear fission was being heavily studied at the time. On one hand, scientists had nuclear fission that could be tested with reactors and radioactive isotopes. On the other, they had nuclear fusion, which is what powers the sun. So far, I've talked a lot about two terms that are going to be super important all the way to the end of this video: nuclear fission and fusion. And that's why I gotta make sure everyone's on the same page, understanding what the two terms mean and what sets them apart. In nuclear fission, we typically start with a heavy atom, like uranium-235. This isotope is special because of its instability. And since nature always prefers stability, that uranium atom will try to stabilize. And it regains its stability by splitting into lighter atoms. But the secret is in the total mass. If the total mass of those lighter atoms that were created when uranium-235 decayed was the same as the uranium, there wouldn't be any nukes in the world, let alone nuclear energy. If you add up the mass of the atoms produced by the decay of uranium, it's always going to be less than the starting mass. It's this mass that apparently was lost that becomes energy. A lot of energy, in fact. If in nuclear fission we have the splitting of an atom into others, in nuclear fusion we've got the opposite. We usually start with a lighter atom, like hydrogen, and stick two or more of them together to make a heavier atom, like helium. If we measure the mass of the helium and compare it with that of initial hydrogen, once again we'd notice some mass has gone missing. It also became energy. Nuclear fission is the process we perform on Earth using reactors and nuclear weapons. It's basically like splitting an atom into others. Nuclear fusion is what the sun does to keep on shining. It merges atoms together. So, now that we've got the basics of how fission and fusion work down pat, we can start to get how a thermonuclear bomb ticks. And here's a side note. Whenever you hear about a thermonuclear bomb, H-bomb, or hydrogen bomb, they're all different terms for the same thing, which is a nuclear bomb that uses nuclear fusion to generate energy and destructive power. The biggest engineering and tech hurdle in building a fusion bomb is hitting the right conditions for fusion to kick off. As the temperature goes up, electrons get ripped off atoms, turning everything into loose atomic nuclei. We call that ions. Thing is, atomic nuclei have a positive charge, and as a result, they will repel each other. We need to reach sufficiently high temperatures and pressures to overcome the repulsion between atomic nuclei. And just so y'all get the picture, the sun can only reach these conditions because it's 333,000 times the mass of Earth. So how can we create those conditions here on our planet? The answer that two physicists, Edward Teller and Stanislaw Ulen, came up with was as follows. Just gotta set off a regular old nuke first. Okay, they didn't say it with these words, but that's the gist of it, at least in a super simplified way, of the Teller-Ulam design. We still don't know exactly how much those two physicists contributed to that idea. Some folks say one worked harder than the other, but given how it was a top secret project, we'll probably never know for sure. In the Teller-Ulen design, the bomb is divided into two or more stages. The minimum is two, and certain bombs, such as the Tsar Bomba, likely had three. The concept is that the initial phase is a nuclear fission bomb, like those in the Manhattan Project. The purpose of this stage is to generate enough energy through nuclear fission so that the second stage can kick off nuclear fusion. Remember when I said we need conditions like those found in the Sun, which is 333,000 times the mass of Earth? So, it's the explosion of the first stage that makes these conditions possible. When the fission bomb goes off, temperatures hit up to the ballpark of 100 million degrees. On this scale, I don't need to specify Celsius, Fahrenheit, or Kelvin, as the difference is negligible. All this energy initiates the second stage, which is predominantly composed of fusion fuel, in other words, light atomic nuclei such as lithium, which means the blast from the first nuke sets up the right conditions for nuclear fusion to kick off, starting the energy release from the second part of the bomb. The Teller-Ulen design is so simple and efficient compared to alternatives, it has become the go-to design in pretty much all modern fusion bombs. And that brings us to the first ever fusion nuclear test in history. November 1, 1952, Eniwetok Atoll, Marshall Islands. The natural path the world took after the success of the fission nuclear bombs was to try and develop ever more powerful weapons. With the Teller-Ulen design increasingly showing potential, the only thing missing was a real-life, full-scale test. The first fusion bomb didn't look much like a bomb, at least not what we'd typically picture when we think of bombs. With the codename Ivy Mike, the bomb weighed 74 tons. It wasn't practical at all to be used as a weapon in real life, especially since the fuel for nuclear fusion, liquid deuterium, needed to be kept at temperatures close to absolute zero. Actually, fun fact, they had to develop the cryogenic technology to be able to reach really low temperatures just to make this test happen. As soon as the bomb went off, a fireball with 5 kilometers of diameter formed around ground zero, about 3.1 miles of explosion. The mushroom cloud reached up to 41 kilometers high, over 4 times Mount Everest's height, the tallest mountain on Earth, and it spread out until about 161 kilometers wide. The explosion was so powerful it created 2 elements that weren't even on the periodic table yet, the einsteinium and fermium. This video could have ended here, with a bomb explosion unleashing 1,000 times the energy of the Hiroshima nuclear bomb, a tragic chapter in history. But I must remind you that we don't always make the best choices. The world was still in the Cold War, and the race for more powerful and destructive weapons was just starting. October 30th, 1961 could have been just another regular day. In a perfect world, this video wouldn't even exist. But at 10,500 meters up, a Tupolev Tu-95 was about to make October 30th, 1961, a date for the history books. And that day would forever be known as the day we created the second sun on Earth. Using the same design as the hydrogen bomb first tested 9 years earlier, it was now the Soviet Union's turn to show off its military might. Nicknamed Tsar Bomba, loosely translated to Emperor of Bombs, was, to this day, the most powerful explosive ever detonated by humans on Earth. The Hiroshima and Nagasaki bombs were on the kiloton scale of energy, meaning 1,000 tons of TNT. The first hydrogen bomb, Ivy Mike, was in the megaton range, meaning 1 million tons of TNT. The Tsar Bomba had an energy potential 100 times greater than that, around 100 megatons of TNT, or 100 million tons. However, the bomb used in the test had its power cut in half. It only unleashed 50 megatons of energy. The fireball had 8 kilometers in diameter, reaching the same altitude as the plane that dropped it. Luckily, the plane was already 39 kilometers away when the bomb went off, but that didn't stop it from feeling the effects. The plane got hit by the shockwave when it was already 205 kilometers out, and that made it drop about 1 kilometer in the air. No wonder, in an official estimate, the aircraft's crew was given about a 50% chance of surviving that mission. This picture shows the mushroom cloud from the explosion, and it doesn't look like much, but the photo was taken 161 kilometers away. And the top of the mushroom cloud reached a whopping 67 kilometers high, over 7 times the size of Mount Everest. The shockwave, in the atmosphere and on the ground, circled the globe 3 times. The flash was seen 1,000 kilometers away, both in Alaska and in Norway, and windows were shattered 484 kilometers away as a direct result of the explosion. The Tsar Bomba explosion forever marked a chapter in human history. Up to now, it's been the most powerful explosive device ever used by humans. And paradoxically, it also marks the end of the quest for ever more destructive weapons. Once we've developed a weapon with a destructive potential we used to associate with gods, what's left? It is not surprising that 2 years later, the Partial Nuclear Test Ban Treaty was signed. The participating countries agreed to stop testing nuclear weapons like hydrogen bombs in the atmosphere. But one thing I always find kinda wild is that most of the stuff I'm talking about in this video went down way, way before I was even born. And for most folks watching me, that's true too. And that gives us the false sense that the dangers of the nuclear arms race are way back in the past. And that these things do not shape our present anymore. But that view is incorrect and pretty naive. The nuclear age is not behind us. We are still in it, living a delicate balance, hoping that our representatives do not make the wrong calls in the heat of the moment. And I hope that by gaining knowledge about the functioning of fusion bombs and their capacity for destruction, we can all become more conscious of the risks they present. And if one day any of us is in a position to do so, maybe we can do everything in our power to ensure that the world and human civilization don't go back to a dark age where success is measured in megatons. Thanks and see you next time.